So now that we have understood how the code is basically arranged into main memory, into this activation records by the compiler, and how this then would be executed, we need to understand the actual values. Okay? So let's assume our instruction pointer is now in worker 4. So we have started here in main, calling worker 1, then we executed whatever lines are here, calling worker 4. Now we are in this line. So what are the actual values? So to understand, we could basically re-execute all these individual statements. So we would see that value x in the main activation record has been set here to 5. So the value will be 5 here. Here in worker 1, we have another variable, which is called x1, which is set to 3. So the value is 3. Also, we had this argument, par1. And when we called worker 1, we called it with the value of x over here. And at this point, x was 5. So basically, the argument par1 will be set to 5. This is what we see here. Likewise, when you call worker 4, now with x1, well, this par4 variable, which is this argument here for worker 4, has been set to the actual value, which is 3. We don't know anything yet about res4, x4, res1, and the result. Okay, so all of them are basically undefined. Let me also mention these arrows here. They basically mean that a memory cell, the information stores information about the location on the memory, so basically the offset of another memory location. So like the return address of worker 4 knows where to run code in worker 1. And also knows where this, you know, where the stack frame of worker 1 starts, such that when I can remove worker 4, I can seamlessly continue processing the code that I now know from this return address, but also with the data on this stack that I need to work on when I execute the code for worker 1. I need to work on the memory region for the worker 1. Good. So now we can have a look at the assembler. And we take here the example from our lecture 3, where we had two numbers, a equals 3, b equals 4, and then we try to add them and store them into a new variable c. In our original example, we simplified this. Now we can extend it by something called the stack pointer. So what is now the stack pointer? All the memory locations that are specified in the code are relative to the register base pointer, which points to the stack frame that we are working on. Okay, so what does this mean? When I work in the code for worker 1, wherever this is placed here in memory, it can be here, it can be up here, whatever it means, my compiler knows that variable res1 is, for example, in this memory location here. Okay, so it knows it is the second memory location here, and it knows this base pointer that points to the start of this frame, so it always can find the memory cells for the respective variable. Okay, so this is what we see here. We see that it moves the value 3 into a memory location that is minus 12 relative to the register base pointer. Then it moves 4 to minus 8 relative to the register base pointer. And then it moves, you know, the value that is on this position into one register, the value on this position into another register, which means basically moves 3 and 4 into those two registers. Then it adds these values, and then at the end it moves the result back into location minus 4 based relative to this register. So what does it mean? Well, all those memory locations, minus 4, minus 8, and minus 12, they are basically the locations of these variables a, b, and c, and they have been assigned by the compiler. And whenever you enter or leave a function, this stack pointer, also called the register base pointer, is basically updated accordingly. So when we run main, we can assume it is over here, the pointer. Then when you call worker 1, the pointer is here. Then you call worker 4, it's here. So that really allows you to write functions that can be executed anywhere on main memory and that can also call each other.